Belfast is built on the River Lagan. It's the river that gave the city its once great prosperity, its world-famous Irish linen industry, and a mighty shipyard that was once the biggest in the world. Today, the river has given its name to a new enterprise, a school, Lagan College. Outwardly, it's much like any other school in the British Isles. But for Northern Ireland, what's happening in this school is nothing short of a revolution. Going to school in Northern Ireland can be a strange experience. For just as surely as apartheid separates black from white, here it's religion that keeps Catholic and Protestant children apart. Protestants go to Protestant schools, and Catholics go to Catholic schools. And for all practical purposes, the religious division is 100%.
Catch you later.
Bye. Bye.
Segregation is not imposed by law. It's the result of tradition and habit, of tribal fear and mutual suspicion. It's one of the causes of sectarian hatred perpetuated in each new generation. Lagan College is the first school in Northern Ireland to break this mould. It's the first school set up with the deliberate aim of bringing Catholic and Protestant children together under the same roof.
What are the roads like? What's the hill like today?
Half of these children are Protestant, and half a Catholic.
Watch the ice in the playground, Ben. Okay. All right.
In any other part of Britain, that would be taken for granted. In Belfast, it is revolutionary. When Lagan College first opened its doors in 1981, it had 28 children. Today it has 166, and next year there'll be 250. Each year, a new form is added. And this process will continue until it becomes a fully-fledged secondary school ranging from 11-year-olds to A-level. The principal, who's been with Lagan College since it started, is Sheila Greenfield.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Miss Greenfield.
We'll start our assembly with the hymn, Seek Ye First.
The idea of integrating Protestants and Catholics seemed to me a very natural, sensible thing to do. If children are going to mix together at work or when they're adult or grow up in the same city together. The other thing was that the parents were to be very much involved in Lagan College. And I believe that if parents and school are in agreement, then the best results happen for their children. Down, please. In all our dealings with one another, we should try to be sincere. We've reached a decision that in no one intake would we ever go beyond a 60-40 parameter. But that hasn't been, in fact, been necessary at all, because from the very beginning, every intake has been quite naturally balanced, and we're now within a 1% equal balance between Protestants and Catholics, and we have had to do nothing at all to secure that. It has happened that way. We're trying very hard to represent the cultures of both the Protestant and Catholic traditions here, and so obviously in our teaching of history, in our teaching of RE, and in our games and our music and our literature, there are probably differences to the curriculum that you might find in a predominantly Catholic or predominantly Protestant school here. The staff are 50-50 by appointment, so when the staff are discussing curriculum, there is a sort of natural inbuilt balance to see that we are representing both traditions equally.
Oscar Tushma, I'm not going to hear you.
It means that as well as the normal range of subjects and sports to be found in any European school, children who wish to do so can play Gaelic football or learn the Irish language. Although Lagan College came into existence expressly to pursue the idea of integration, it's not preoccupied with that idea every minute of the day. Educational standards in Northern Ireland are high, and Lagan College is as concerned about the quality of its education as it is about integration.
What has happened to it?
What's happened to most of it, Giles?
It's dissolving.
It's dissolving. And so what does heating help then? If you heat something, it helps.
Is it pure? It makes
no,
it
doesn't.
Make it into a liquid?
Yes, it helps it dissolve.
Lagan is a co-educational comprehensive. It's an all-ability school and there's no streaming.
For the evaporation, you could do questions 5, question 6, question 7, and that's all for the minute.
These conditions seemed likely for a moment to unite Catholic and Protestant workers despite their political differences, but the hope of unity was short-lived. Unionist leaders again emphasised the sectarian divisions.
History is a delicate subject in Ulster. Brian Lamkin teaches history and RE. He's a Catholic.
Well, the future Prime Minister, Sir Basil Brooke, said, "I would appeal to loyalists wherever possible to employ good Protestant lads and lassies." Can anybody see his side of it? Why was he doing that? Did he just say that because he was nasty? Or would he have a good reason for saying?
Sir, anybody? He's maybe trying to solve the problems in the factories by doing that, trying to separate Catholics and Protestants from different factories and things like that, so they wouldn't be fighting and arguing, things like that.
Suppose you had an opportunity at that time to go and talk to Sir Basil Brooke. Jane, would you have gone to him and said, "Well, I think I really agree with you"?
No.
What would you have said to him?
I don't know, I'm going to tell him that it wasn't being fair and that he should divide it more equally, all the jobs more equally throughout the factories.
To everybody?
Uh-huh. Doesn't matter, it depends more if you're a good worker than what religion you're.
Right.
So are you saying with this Prime Minister here in the 1930s, why didn't the Protestants and Catholics get together?
Yes.
Well, so obviously if Sir Basil Brooke was for the Protestants and gave them all the jobs, they weren't going to turn around and say, "We'll get all the Catholics," and we're just going to stick to his rule.
Do you mean if you'd been a Protestant in the 1930s and you'd got your job, you wouldn't have risked your job, you wouldn't have risked your job by joining up with Catholics to, say, form a political party or a trade union?
They're not going to sacrifice their lives. When you were given all these jobs, would you go and share it? And you'd a family to raise?
Well, it's the same.
So, honestly,
yeah.
You might say now, "Oh yes, I'd be the safer and I'd give Catholics my jobs," but even if it was absolutely happening to you, if you had 5 kids or something, you had a wee tiny house and you had no food and your wee rags on you and everything, you wouldn't say, "Well, I'm going to be the saviour of the day and give it to someone else."
Well, is that a problem?
Just to unite, because it isn't going to unite the whole country anyway. It's going to give one Catholic.
There's no doubt in my mind anyway that having children of different denominations together in the same classroom does contribute to the learning process, especially with regard to the teaching of Irish history. I think the very fact that the children are sitting down together, engaged in academic study together, is a statement in itself about Irish history. Just not to say that they all end up agreeing on some compromised view of history, but it demonstrates that children can study together the subject and reach their own conclusions about the evidence, but do it together without coming to blows. I think what's heartening about working in the college is that it's an institution to which both Catholics and Protestants can give their loyalty. And that for me is a sign, looking around. You ask yourself, how many other institutions can that be said of in the province at the moment? So here you've got Catholic and Protestant children with loyalty to one school, learning what adults regard as sensitive subjects, namely religious education and history together. And so that fills me with hope.
Yes, Connor.
So when you go to for an interview for a job, do they ask you if you're a Protestant or a Catholic?
I don't know, do they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So they try to sort of sneak it in, they sort of...
But I think it's a real waste of time even looking to see what you are. You're just the same as everybody else.
What would you do in that situation?
Well, if I was, and you had to write down your school, well, then I would write down my school. But I would, as I would write Lagan College down, they wouldn't know whether or what I was.
It's February 1984, make or break year for Lagan College. So far, it has existed on donations, grants from charitable trusts, and fees of £600 a year. But the principal knows that most avenues of charity are now exhausted. And if Lagan is not to go to the wall, it must be accepted into the state-aided educational system. Each day, the principal waits for an answer from the Minister of State to the school's application to be received into the state-funded sector. If the minister says yes, the segregation stalemate in Northern Ireland will be broken, and a cross-section of children from both sides can continue to be educated together.
That's interesting. Letter from Germany. Wants to know progress we've made since the foundation of the college.
Oh, that's interesting. Have we ever heard from them before?
Marvellous. And that's £10 from a parent and £5 anonymous.
Oh, that's very nice.
Fantastic. Just looking at that one. I'd just like another one. £27. Isn't that marvellous?
That's a joke, yes. Mm.
Lagan College came about because parents passionately wanted integrated education for their children. The root of the problem lies in the curious construction of the boards of management that run Northern Ireland schools. In effect, the law allows the churches to have complete control of these boards. A prime mover in the bid to change this system was Cecilia Linehan, a Belfast dentist. In 1973, a statement was read out in her local Catholic church that confirmation would be withheld from any children attending non-Catholic schools. This brought home to her the harsh realities of segregated education. She got together with a small group of other dismayed parents, and they decided to call themselves All Children Together.
The All Children Together movement began, and it still is. A group of parents began with Catholic parents who were shortly joined by Protestant parents of all denominations. And the thrust always has been to try to change the laws which govern the control of schools here, because we believe that the churches have an excessive representation on the boards of management. We are not anti-church. It's a very difficult thing to say. We believe there are too many churchmen on the boards of management and not be accused of being anti-clerical. We are against the churches being in control of schools for our children. But we are very keen to see them where we believe their true role is, in the pastoral role of the care of children in schools. Four opinion polls have been carried out in Northern Ireland, and no matter how sceptical you are about them, it was remarkable. Well over 70% of the entire adult community wanted to see children going to school together, and yet we are locked in this segregated system.
That's the first thing. Now, the next thing is that letter to parents, that the draft one.
Okay.
That has been approved. Thanks, I haven't seen it. If I could just see a copy of it. And...
The movement was gathering strength, and in 1978 it managed to get an act passed by Parliament affecting the management boards. This act made it simple to set up integrated schools in any part of Northern Ireland where parents so wished. But time passed and nothing happened.
The whole act itself depends on goodwill existing between the churches, and our hope lay, I must say, mainly with the Protestant churches, because over the years the All Children Together movement had read, and everybody here had read, how the Church of Ireland and the Presbyterian Church passed resolutions at their conferences and their synods in favour of integrated education. The Catholic Church was always quite unequivocal in that it believed that her children, Catholic children, must be educated in Catholic schools, in Ireland anyway, but we have noted that they had developed shared schools in other places. To our disappointment, we have to say that the All Children Together movement noted that within 2 years after the passing of that 78 Education Act, only one school in Belfast had tried to use it, and that school was in fact threatened with closure. So during 79 and 80 there was further agonising going on, and at the same time we had this balance of people saying, I'm not going to wait any longer, I do not wish my child to grow up in a segregated system. Finally, in 1981 there was a resolution brought forward to the annual general meeting of the All Children Together movement asking that the executive committee would support a proposal to start an integrated all-ability secondary school. And the Lagan College was born.
Well, you need to start looking when you get the chance.
Yes. Have you been to any other schools?
This is the only school I'm really interested in, you know, at the minute.
Why is that?
Because it's a good school, you know.
Well, put the names down. Because in 3 years' time, I'm not going to have room. If I tell you I have a waiting list to 1988,
Basil McIver was Minister of Education in the last Northern Ireland government. He introduced his own shared schools plan, but the government collapsed before it could be put into effect. Undeterred, he joined the All Children Together movement at its beginning, and today he's chairman of the Board of Governors of Lagan College.
Well, there is no question about it. People are afraid of this. The churches are afraid of this. There is a question of losing authority, or appearing to lose authority, losing power on the boards. It certainly would diminish the power of the churches, and they're hesitant to do that. And that's why, as I said before, this is not going to happen through any initiative, it seems to me, on the part of the churches. It's going to be the initiative of parents themselves. We're talking about people not having preconceived ideas about one another, not being anxious about one another, not being fearful about one another, not adopting a siege mentality. I think I've always I was, as you know, Minister of Community Relations, and the whole idea of that was for people to climb over the wall and talk to people on the other side. And this is what we're talking about, communication. If they're schooled together, if they grow up together, form friendships, and learn about little intimacies that they have with one another, for, 190 days in the school year, 6.5 hours a day, 5 days a week, I just cannot believe that friendships will not be formed then, which will subsist throughout their lives.
Right, you're driving Minnie up the road. When you hear my hands clap, the lights change. Suddenly red. Slam on your brakes. You're going to collide. Take it from that point. What's going to happen?
Oh, Jesus. My car. Oh, no. Look at my car. You're both of them.
And like, I was so killing. The lights came on.
I thought that brand new name in the dark store, Mac.
What about my name? I don't.
You're ringing
the police. I'm ringing the police.
£3,000. £3,000.
I don't care about my money. That's all I know.
You're a liar.
That's all I know.
Pigs.
Officer, he struck me. He struck me just because when in the back of his car. He's
like, you know, you know the law, officer. Officer, you know the law.
Finish. Finish there. Were you a little bit frightened of Catholics?
I wouldn't say friend, but I didn't know them, so I hadn't really got to know any before, so I was a wee bit apprehensive to come and a bit reluctant. But now I've got to know people, other Catholics. They're no different than any other children. And look, although we fight over other things, we never really fight over denomination, things like that. And they're just like any other children.
You don't really bother asking, like, are you Catholic or Protestant?
Well, at the beginning you were really suspicious and you wanted to. I found that and I started trying to get out of them what they were, but it never really came to me as a surprise. You know, if I'd say Jean was a Protestant, I wouldn't be offended by her. I'd just have her as a natural friend.
When I first came to the school, I found out I didn't know much sort of about the way the Catholics' way of life and things like that. Now I know a good bit about them, so I do. For instance, went and visited a Catholic church last year, and things I hadn't even known before, like confession boxes and things like that, the way they go in there and do that, and those sort of different kinds of things in their church.
I didn't know that there were groups of Protestants, like Presbyterian churches, and I didn't know that until I came here.
If I had a chance to mix, I mean, people wouldn't be as suspicious towards each other. Yeah. And people, the hardliners and all, if they would only, like, stop for a minute to think, you know, can I get on with these people? I mean, I'm sure they would find that they can.
There are about 4 or 5 middle schools in Northern Ireland. There's one not very far from here, where there are people who, Catholic and Protestant, who went together, working in the mill together, went to school together, and they're now in their 70s and 80s, and there's no chance of them ever falling out on religious or political grounds. They are friends. Now, at that age, this is an object lesson. In my view, it's a small area, I know, but this is what can happen with an integrated system.
Bow your heads for each other
and for our good.
We thank you, Lord. Amen. Sit down.
No, I've got mine. We have 2 glasses.
Miss, can I have a glass of water, please?
2 glasses.
Another glass.
Is there a glass of water?
No, not yet. Bring your water now.
Yeah. Miss, can I have an apple?
No, just soup.
Is this your apple glass?
Yes.
All right?
No.
All right?
No pot noodles in here?
No.
As the weeks pass without any word or hint from the Minister of State, anxiety for the school's future grows. The day-to-day expenses and the cost of expansion to accommodate the growing numbers are stretching the school's strained finances to breaking point. No one is more aware of this than Lagan's treasurer, Tony Spencer.
We are not devotees of private education. We believe that we are morally entitled as taxpaying citizens to a share in the education budget. We believe in public education. And we are frankly dismayed that it takes us 3 years before we're even going to be considered for admission to the state grant-aided system. Whereas, for example, it's perfectly possible for a Catholic school to be admitted, a new Catholic school can be admitted to the state grant-aided system at the drawing board stage before a single brick has been laid. And yet we have to go through 3 years of showing that there's a demand for it. So we've been through this apprenticeship. We must get into the state system. We don't want to be an elitist school with simply for upper middle class children. We've already gone to a great deal of trouble to ensure that plenty of children from poor homes have places at Lagan. More than half the children at Lagan, the parents either pay nothing or pay very little, and less than half pay the full fee. Even the full fee doesn't anywhere near cover the cost of the teaching at the college. So it's essential that we get into the voluntary grant-aided system like virtually every other school in Northern Ireland.
In Northern Ireland, there's a new generation of parents, better educated, less cowed by the church. In the real world of unemployment and the microchip, they want a much greater say in the running of the schools their children attend. It's parents like Oliver and Cora Hunter who reject the bigoted past to whom Lagan owes its creation and its support.
Yeah,
The Hunters are Catholics who live in South Belfast. Their younger daughter, Nessa, is in her first year at Lagan College.
Well, when Nessa came towards the end of her primary school, we were looking around at schools in general, both Catholic grammar schools and state grammar schools, as I prefer to call them, and were keen on integration from the point of view of colour, because we lived in Bermuda and colour was a problem there, and religion, and sex, and the whole, we feel that segregation at any level is divisive, and it's important that people get along with one another on, you know, every level. So then, you know, all children together set up, had public meetings about a proposed integrated school, and we went along to the meetings and were very impressed. And then we just followed the thing on from there, and as soon as the school
got off the ground,
we registered Nessa, and we also made the decision to send her whether or not she got qualifying. Well, she did, and
we're more than pleased with...
Yeah, particularly with, you know, with our academic process. It's excellent. She's certainly not suffering at any level.
Everybody pays lip service to this thing about integrated education. You know, integrated education is Protestants going to Catholic schools or Catholics going to Protestant schools. This is more assimilation. Now, the people in Northern Ireland believe this to be integration. They see this as integration, that you come to my school and we'll all live happily ever after. But it just doesn't work. And you've got to make a positive decision that you're going to set up another school and people are going to come in from both sides, they're going to come in cold, and they will develop from there.
Taff Lodge is a predominantly Catholic area of West Belfast. Its political sympathies are plain to see. Desmond Hockey is a Catholic with two daughters. Maeve is still at primary school, and Katrina started at Lagan College this year. His own education at an all-Catholic school was good, but he never met any Protestants, and he developed fears and suspicions about the other side. In Belfast, they kill people out of blind ignorance of the other side.
Thank you.
I would not claim that integrated education is a cure to all ills. I don't think anybody who supports integrated education believes that, but it can contribute a tremendous amount. During the early 70s, a friend of mine was murdered by paramilitaries while playing table tennis. Which side he was on doesn't really matter. He was murdered for the simple reason that he was a representative of the other side. And I couldn't help feeling at the time that those people who murdered him wouldn't have seen his face and wouldn't have regarded him as a real human being. He was a cipher, a representative of something that they opposed, somebody maybe that they regarded as not really quite human. And if they had gone to school with that chap, or if they'd even gone to school with someone like him, they would have had to think, when they were shooting him, that he was a friend of Jimmy's, or that was Jimmy I went to school with down the road. Maybe he's one of them, but basically he's a decent fella. I remember the time he helped me against the bully. I remember the time he lent me a couple of bob to go and buy some sweets. You know, it's simple things like that. I'm convinced that if we'd had integrated education for the last 30 years, the troubles in Northern Ireland could not have taken the course they would have now. People, while still being opposed to each other's views on certain issues, would have at least been better able to understand each other's views. There would have been... we would maybe have been able to behave more like the English, who are very pragmatic and always find a middle course. The English believe that there's always some common ground somewhere. In Northern Ireland, and Ireland as a whole, in fact, people tend not to believe this. People tend to think, I'm right, therefore you're wrong. If I'm completely right, you're completely wrong. And there's only one way to deal with people who are completely wrong. You stamp on them.
So each Catholic, there he is there, and he goes to see his parish.
One of the original 28 children who came to Lagan when it opened in 1981 was Christopher Perry. His parents, Pauline and Jimmy, had lived all their lives on Belfast's fiercely Protestant Shankill Road.
Before Christopher's born, I thought, I cannot bring him up in this place. I can't, because they're so one-tracked. So we moved. We moved to East Belfast, where there was more scope, more opportunity to meet other people. The school was a godsend.
It really was a godsend. It just appeared when we needed it.
I remember you telling me that you really felt that you wanted to do your bit mm-hmm. for integration, that you were sick and tired of the sectarian division.
Very sick of it.
Very
sick of it. Of the
whole lot of it.
Bickering and the troubles and the slogans. And very sick of it. And there wasn't a lot as two people we could do about it, except what we did, enroll our son in Lagan. That's as much as we could do about it. You wouldn't have known anything, only same old war cry. No surrender. That's all he would have known. We decided to send Christopher to Lagan. We said yes first and then asked about the fees. And when we heard the fees were £600, we nearly fainted. We realised that we couldn't pay £600. So asked Mr. Spencer and he says, don't worry about it.
Sort something out.
We'll sort something out. Well, then they did. They got bursaries and that, which meant that we could afford to, even though we could afford to pay very little of the fee.
Well, very good.
Do you know, I think if I had found that money, I still would have. It would have been almost impossible for us to do it, but I think we would have done it anyhow. In fact, we'd even talked about it because at that time they didn't have anything sorted out financially for people who couldn't afford the fees. And we came home and talked about it and decided even if we had to do without, we would find the money.
Mm-hmm.
Would mean maybe paying it by instalments, but we would have done it. We'd have paid by instalments even.
Maybe I told Polly, I says, if these going to have an education I never had, I don't care what it's going to cost or where they're going to go, but they're going to have their education.
Well, somebody has to start. My children were all born with the bombs and the bullets. They were born then and they're looks like they're going to go on hearing them. Just somebody had to start.
In the Presbyterian Church, you're baptised during...
Lagan is staunchly Christian. There are three RE periods a week. For one of these three periods, classes divide into smaller groups which are taught by visiting chaplains. There are five in all corresponding to the various denominations, but all five are Protestant.
Do you know when they're asked at the christening, say, you know how you ask them those questions, say they say no to them, what happens?
Well, they can't have them baptised then. If people come together and learn to understand each other, there's a better chance that they get on together.
It's not going to make any difference. You just can do all, everybody can talk to you all the time that they want, but they're still going to think
about the same things. But it's making a difference here, it's making a difference.
This is just one small school.
But the Catholic children at Lagan College have no Catholic chaplain.
We have not at this time felt it reasonable to ask the Bishop of Down and Connor to provide us with a chaplain. We feel that he has many pressures upon him and that it would be probably unwise at this point to ask him to take such a decision.
Why?
He knows very well of our existence, and we feel it would be better for him to take the initiative.
I think that's really a question for the Catholic Church. They have obviously decided not to supply a chaplain. I think this is typical of their attitude. At the same time, I think it would be much better if there were a Catholic chaplain. It would make the situation much more rounded, much more balanced. But if there's a fault that lies there, it's not the fault of Lagan College or of the parents, it is the fault of the Catholic Church, who have chosen not to send a chaplain.
I feel the Church, at this time, is protecting the establishment of the Catholic Church and are not looking at the spirit of the Church. They're more interested in the institution than they are in
the needs of their congregations.
Yes, and the message that the churches are supposed to be giving. And I feel because those boys and girls are there, and if the church don't like it, let them come with the parents, but don't penalise the children, because religion is an important part of people's education.
As appeal followed appeal, the school somehow kept going through January and February. A decision on its application to be let into the state system would have to be made before the new financial year at the beginning of April.
To put it this way, it has cost us between £400,000 and £500,000 to reach the stage of applying to get into the system. The cost of running the college is, what, £20,000 at least a month. We have just built on the site, providing extra accommodation. We've got to build again to take to account for the intake in September 1984. And I think Lagan College is in real trouble. I don't think we can hope to continue to rely on charities and well-wishers, benefactors, to continue indefinitely. It is a make or break year. There is no question about that. We've got to get into the system.
Parent wish is a very important thing for the minister to listen to. And I also think that we are going to meet the criterion for viability in terms of pupil numbers without any shadow of doubt. And so I hope he will give Lagan College a chance to be a third alternative for parents within the system.
On March the 1st, the long-awaited letter arrived from the Minister of State.
Ladies and gentlemen! Could I have your attention a minute? I have here a very important letter from the Department of Education, which I would like to read to you. As from the 1st of April 1984, Lagan College shall be recognised as a grant-aided school providing secondary education for both boys and girls. The distinctive feature of the college will remain its interdenominational integrated character.